Today's scripture reading is Matthew 6:19-21. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures in earth where moth and rust be destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where their treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we are nothing. There is nothing we can do to express your love and your plans. Therefore, we pray that your spirit may touch every heart. You know every single person here. You know their needs, their struggles. You know the plans that you have for them. You know those that are watching via internet. Father, we ask that you touch every heart with your spirit, that it all may be for your glory. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. How would you like to... Hold on a second. Let me start this. Good. How would you like to find a treasure? How many of you would enjoy to actually find a real treasure? Would you? Oh, I love that. I was a kid. I don't remember how old. Probably I was about 10 years old. I was in the third or fourth grade, somewhere there, 9, 10, more or less. And as I was walking from my house to a church meeting, to a children meeting with the pastor, my way to the church would go on a street called Eminescu, and then it would go down like a hill. That many times I would take the sled and go on that hill. And as it would go down, in the middle of the road, there was a big, we called it Alimentara. That was a grocery store. In the middle of the road was a big building, extremely old, that had a lot of groceries inside and a lot of fresh meat. You would go and see the whole cow, and they would say, "What do you want?" And you say, "From here." And they would actually cut from you from there. And they would cut them fresh daily. Anyway, and the road would go around that building and then unite again and continue, like a roundabout. You follow me? Well, in that place, by that big grocery store, there was an extremely big oak. And when you say big, I mean big. When I say big, I would say that it took several people to be able to surround the oak. I'm not sure if it was an oak, but that's what I think. If my mom was here, she would tell you precisely what that tree was. But it was very old and very thick and very big on the sidewalk. And they put a little fence around it because they said it's so old that it's historical and nobody should touch it. Well. One night, as I was coming back from church, I see something extremely strange. By the old tree, there were flames coming from the ground, fire. Exactly as you hear me. And I said, "This is strange, this is crazy, because there is no fire." But the flames were coming out, appearing and disappearing. There, a flame. There, a flame. Here, a flame. What is that? So I go home and tell my dad. And my dad gave me a story. And my dad never lied to me. He was an honest man. So I do believe that what he told me was true, you know. My dad said to me that, that somebody long before the war, and he knew the guy. And before communism took over Romania, when communists took over, they confiscated all gold. Nobody was allowed to have gold. If you had one coin of gold, they would take it and beat you close to death to confess if you have more hidden coins. And even if you didn't, they would beat you so bad that you would tell everything. I mean, basically, it was safer not to give it to them because they would never believe that you gave it all. And they would beat you to say if you have more. Anyway, so my dad said that there was a man who was very rich, and he put it in a jar, a lot of gold. When the communism came into the country, he buried it somewhere, and the man lived there. That property was his property, and that tree was on his property, and the communist government confiscated the property and the house and everything. And my dad said to me, "Listen, son, any type of metal, including gold, is going to eventually experience some oxidation, because it's not pure gold, but it has some other metals, like an alloy in it. And because it has other metals, they, because of some bacteria, go through that chemical process called oxidation. And when that happens, it's leaching ions that create slowly, that gas creates some pressure. And after a few years, eventually, that pressure, that gas, escapes through the ground. And when it hits oxygen, it becomes flames." And my dad said, it's called halo effect. You see it behind that parking? That light? That's a halo effect. This is another one, halo effect. Do you see it? Basically, it shows up here, and then it shows up here, and then 2-3 years, it doesn't show up. But then it builds pressure again, and you see it again. And treasure hunters see it, and they say, "I got a treasure!" And before they see it somewhere there or there, before they get to the place, there is no more flames. Disappears. So it's kind of deceiving. And my father said, "I am not sure if that's the place, but it could be." So I started to make plans. I'm going to pretend that I am a utility worker, and one day just be bold enough and put some things there, like those red rubber things that they put on the road, and put a kind of a suit for utility worker and start digging and say, "There are pipes broken in the ground," and look for the gold. What if I find it? I am rich. And then my friend said, "No, we should buy a gold detector and find it." Well, we never did it. But Just to mention, people did use to bury their treasures, and some of them still do. And, you know, people would go to extreme measures to make sure that their treasures are safe. For instance, the internet says that you can buy a PVC pipe that has 2 caps. You keep 1 cap on, you put your treasure inside, then put the other cap on, you bury it, the internet says in the instruction part, 6 feet under the ground, and then, in order to remember where you put it, you cover it with 3 feet of ground, and then you put some scrap metal over, and then you put another 3 feet of dirt, and then, when you want to find it, you go to your neighbor, and you borrow the metal detector. Sure, you don't tell him what is the metal detector for, because then he's going to come during the night and dig it up. You borrow it. You say, "Hey, I'm just curious, how does this function?" And you pretend you are stupid, you know, and you buy it, and then you go and you find the scrap metal. And as you find the scrap metal, you dig, and then you dig another 3 feet, and you find your treasure. Isn't that smart? It is safe because it says on the internet. Yeah, thank you, yes. But listen, there are some people that may realize he needs the metal detector, and they are not full. So they may come with the metal detector in the night and look for your treasure. So this is what the internet says you should do to keep it safe. You should dig several holes and put scrap metal everywhere. So they dig here, 3 feet, find scrap metal, it's not here. They dig here and there, and even if they find the place with the treasure, they don't think that they have to dig another 3 feet deeper under the scrap metal. But what the internet doesn't say, what do you do if you forget where it is? Do you start digging all the scrap metals all over? That doesn't, the internet doesn't explain that part. So, what, yeah, people are kind of paranoid to protect their investments and treasures and everything. So, oh, by the way, I remember a very nice story that I read. Do you remember the old can openers that you would stab the can and then you would literally cut it and sometimes you would hurt yourself, it was dangerous, you remember those? Right now they have a little better openers. They just basically what they do, they lift the lid. You know what I am talking about, don't you? Okay, I read a story where a man wanted to hide his treasure, his money that he saved all his life, and he thought, where should I put them that my wife doesn't spend them at the mall and nobody finds them? So you know what he did? He actually put them in a green beans can. And he put them in the pantry. Who would come to rob a house and look into the pantry between the vegetables? Well, by the way, my father-in-law did that. He had some money saved and he put them in the butter can in the refrigerator. Guess what? When I wanted to put butter and jelly, I found his money. I said, hey, I found money in the butter can. He said, no, that's mine. And he changed the place. After all, it was not so safe. Anyway, back to the story. The guy put money in the green beans can. One day, some people came to do fundraising and food raising for the homeless. Oh, I think you already know what happened next. And so, he was not home. And his wife, having a good heart, she gave some vegetable cans. You know what follows, don't you? He came home and he goes crazy. Where is my green beans? And she says, honey, it's plenty of green beans. Not that green beans, my green beans. And she says, all green beans is the same. Or garbanzo or whatever. I prefer green beans, but anyway. So imagine somewhere a homeless man, instead of eating for lunch garbanzo, he got the treasure of his life. That, yeah, you know. So much for trying to protect your treasures on earth. The words that I share today from Jesus may seem out of place, but this society, we need them badly. So Jesus gives us extremely precious, vital counsel for a world that tries really hard to save, lay up treasures on earth instead of on heaven. So this is what Jesus says. Do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth, where moths and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moths nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So the Greek word actually there doesn't say do not save, do not have any savings, do not be wise to have an emergency fund. Doesn't say don't spend more than you earn. Doesn't say spend it all or save it all. Doesn't say don't be responsible. What the Greek literally says, this is the word-by-word pure translation, do not keep continually saving. Do not continually keep on saving treasures. Do not keep doing it. You follow me? That's the literal translation. Don't keep doing that forever. Don't put your trust in them. Don't let your mind be stressed over them. Have some limits. Well, some people have a big limit. It's never enough for them. But the Bible talks about some balance, wise balance. So, why would Jesus say that? And I'm going to give you three reasons that are in the text right there. Why not to keep on continually laying up treasures, being stressed about things, stuff, money on earth. Three reasons in the Bible verse. He says, number one, what? What happens to them? Moths and rust destroy them. The italics destroy. I'm going to give you the translation. Doesn't mean destroy. It means deteriorate, lose value, disappear. Well, let's move on a little. I remember going to my great-grandmother, countryside, old woman. She was extremely, extremely, extremely rich. And when the communists came, took all her property that was around 20-some kilometers, all her property, by Danube River, and it was forest and land and everything. Water, you name it. She had many cows, like, I don't know, 50, 100, 200. She had 400, 500 sheep, and she was rich. They took it all, and she had nothing left over. And I remember talking to her, and I said, Grandma, are you okay with it? And she smiled, and she says, Son, when I die, I don't take it with me, son. I said, I know, but until then, I said, well, but until then, I have Jesus. I said, yeah, but you got to survive. I said, well, doesn't Jesus say that we don't live only with bread? And she said, he means that, son, if you don't believe, then stop going to church, you lose your time. She was kind of very serious about it. And then I would go to get my clothes in vacation and change, go to play, come back. When I would open those old, full wood, I don't even know how you call them, wardrobes, old, when I opened it, there was a bad smell inside of mothballs. You know what those are? Mothballs. I said, Grandma, why do you put this? Oh, against moths. Obviously, the moth didn't like that smell, that thing that she would purchase and put it in the wardrobe. And she says, Son, I need this clothing. I really need to get dressed to go to work. That's the reason I protect myself. Do you know that in that time, not my grandmother, but in all times, a Babylonian robe was so expensive that it would take several years of work to buy one robe? And did you know that a robe could have been eaten by moths in less than a week? Uh-huh. Oh, by the way, Achan lost his life over a robe. You remember? Elisha's servant, Gehazi, lost his health over a robe. You remember? Yeah, we can actually lose a lot over some stuff. Jesus says, don't be obsessed. Don't be obsessed with them. Don't get stressed. Catastrophes, nature, moths, rust can totally destroy them. Is not worth losing your life, your salvation, your health over it. Now, in that money, in that time, gold was the symbol for money because money were of gold. That's the reason money had value in that time, not like today. Money, when they say gold, they meant also money. As far as I know, gold doesn't rust. So I looked into the Greek. When it says that gold will rust, in fact, in the Greek, it doesn't say so. It says that it's going to lose value. And it doesn't refer, if you talk to a Jewish person, it doesn't refer to gold. It refers to coins, to money. So I talked to some Jewish people and some scholars. And I called Dr. Davidson in Andrews some time ago. And he said, it doesn't refer to gold being rusted. It refers to economy collapsing. If the economy would collapse, your money have no value. You may have money, but you may not be able to use them. You'll not be able to buy or to sell. You follow me? If the economy, in fact, where it says that the angel took a rock and threw it in the water and said, so fast shall Babylon fall. It doesn't refer to Babylon as a country, but to the economy that is going to collapse like a rock goes to the bottom of the water. In no time, overnight, the economy would collapse. It will happen. It's just a matter of time. I am not a prophet. That's in the Bible. It will happen. And then all the money you have will have zero value. For instance, in Romania, after revolution, within a week, we lost all our money. I had about 70,000 that I could have bought like 2 new cars. Within a week, I was able to buy 1 pound of sugar with 70,000. The inflation was so fast that today the pastor's salary was 2,400. Next day, it was about 20,000. Within a week, we got to about $2 million a month salary. I mean that. The inflation, so the Romanian money would catch up with the dollars. When we got out of communism, the inflation was so bad that our money lost value overnight. And all the money that you saved all your life were zero. You could go and just buy some chewing gum, and that's it. All your treasure. Money can lose value. And overnight, we may become poor. And all our stress could have been for nothing. I hope you realize that. A tornado can take it away. A fire can take it away. Cancer can take it away. Economy can fall and take it away. Don't imagine that you have the money invested in the house. The house will keep value. Homes can lose value too. Anyway, I'm not going to insist there. But they, according to Jesus, they can lose value. So, what is the second reason? The first is that they lose value. They deteriorate. They disappear. But the second reason, Jesus says, thieves break in and steal it. And the Greek word is klepto, or we have the English kleptomania. Basically, Jesus says that it's not just that the economy may collapse, but somebody can actually take them from you. And what can you do about it? Have you ever been robbed? Yes? How many of you have been robbed ever? I've been robbed, as far as I know, twice. Yeah, I hate it. I thought nobody can rob me, but they did it. One time, I had a friend, neighbor, classmate, that lost his job, and he was married, and he had a small baby, and I owned a big business. So he came to me, I need help, we don't have food. I felt sorry for him and hired him in my business and gave him a big salary. Well, when I was not home, he found a way into my safe place. There is nothing safe. And he took around 700,000, 760,000 precisely, all close to a million. And that was not in Romanian money. That was a big value. We took close to a million. If somebody came and took close to $1 million, what would you do? Basically, all our savings, Dana and I, overnight had nothing. He took it all and he disappeared. And he spent it within about 3 months, all. And even if I sued him, I didn't have proof, though he told everybody that, you know, he got my money. So Dana and I just started all over again, and we made it back. And then they called us to ministry, and we gave up everything anyway. That's okay. Yeah, he took our money, believe it or not. And one time, I had an Acura that I bought, and it was a stolen car, and I did everything properly. But by God's grace, it was recovered. So, yeah, people can take it from you, believe me, it's not safe. But there is another reason that we should not put our trust in stuff. And Jesus mentions the third most important reason. Jesus says, lay up treasures in heaven, because this is the third reason, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Do you remember the song, I'm satisfied with just a cottage below. You know, don't you? Sing it to me if you know it. A little silver and a little gold. But in that city, when the ransomed we shine, I want a gold one, that silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold. What is the song talking about? What does he say? But in that city, I've got the mansion. Focusing on that city, compared to the other song, if you remember, I left my heart in San Francisco. You remember the song? You can leave your heart there or there. You got to choose. Let me ask you. Oh, it is so nice to say, oh, how I love Jesus. But it is something to say it and something else to mean it and to do it. And let me tell you, numbers talk better than words. Wherever you spend your time and your money and whatever you invest in, that's where your heart is, in that city, or I left my heart in San Francisco. You follow me? Yeah, yeah. If you want your heart to be in heaven now, and not only now, but for eternity, then your affections, your emotions, your desire, your goals, your thoughts, your words, all of them, your time, your energy, your resources should focus on heaven, because we are called Adventists. That means we are waiting for the second coming. Are we still waiting? How do we prove that we are waiting? How are we different from the world? What do you invest in? Do our daily life practically says we are waiting for that city? We are preparing for that city. Do our plans, our investments talk about the fact that we are practically, literally, physically preparing for that city? Let me give you these two examples. There was a lady neighbor with us called Safta. And she would talk and then run and then, no! I said, what's wrong with her? Well, Safta, she was so rich. She saved all her life and communists took it all and she lost her mind. That's one. The other one, my grandpa. He had a lot and he was in the war. And his neighbor that was a Seventh-day Adventist too, the bomb came over his house. And the story is long, but he asked my grandma to let him and his family to live with my grandma and her family in their home. And for a few months, he lived there free. And then my grandma, having 9 children and husband in the war, didn't have money to pay mortgage for a month and borrow some money from the neighbor that lived in their home for free. And then was unable to pay it back. And he sued her and took her house. Did you hear what I said? And my grandpa came from war and said, honey, you sleep in some member's house in the basement. Where is our house? And she told the story. And she said, should we sue him? And my grandpa said, oh, let's pray for him. Let him enjoy it. We will build another one. My heart is there, not here. This is going to burn up. I could not care less. You follow me? Not losing his mind that he lost the house. Are you losing your mind when you lose something? Are you getting stressed when you lose a job or a house? Are you really getting stressed? Huh? Yes or no? That should tell where your heart and your treasure is. What do we focus on? This or that? You follow me? That should say a lot. Don't just be thinking continually about this stuff now and here. Don't allow yourself to plan about this, talk about this, be stressed about this. Don't just invest in here. Try to look more towards heaven. Make heaven the priority in all that you do. Seek first the kingdom of God, and Jesus promised the other things, all will be given, added. You don't need to get stressed. You just need to trust Jesus, literally. I remember my grandpa, I would go to him, and he was always singing second coming songs, nothing else. And he would preach always second coming sermons. And I said, grandpa, don't you know other songs? He said, well, I do. But my heart is already there. That's what he always said, literally. You ask anybody in my church where I grew up, anybody, I don't care, 270 members, anybody. And my grandpa, all his sermons, and he preached a lot, he was a head elder all his life. All his sermons were second coming, all his songs were second coming. And they would ask him why, and he would say, there is nothing else that I live for. That's what I'm waiting for. I'm already there. I'm already there. Are you there? Remember the angels going to Sodom and trying to get Lot and his house, his family out, pleading with them, leave it all and go if you want to leave. What did they do? Compare Lot and Abraham, relatives. God asked Abraham to leave it and go. What did Abraham do? Abraham left it all, gave it up. Job, family, relatives, house, garden, 50 acres, whatever. He had more than that. Lot, leave it alone and go. And Lot and his wife and the children said, we cannot. We have a house, we have a job, we have this TV and this car that we have to pay for. We are kind of stuck here. You remember the story? So the angels had to basically force them, pull Lot and his wife and his unmarried children, pull them out and say, go if you want to leave. And you know, their mind was so messed up that they were ready to give their unmarried daughters to those men. You remember? Listen, folks, listen carefully. This is bad. You can take people out of Sodom, but it's very hard to take Sodom out of them. When you live in the wrong place, instead of you influencing the place is going to influence you. I mean, ready to give his unmarried daughters to those men? There's something wrong with his head. And his wife looked back. Oh, I'm going to lose my business and my job and my house and my car and nice furniture. Oh. And she lost her life and her eternal life. Could it be that we got so comfortable here that we would rather lose our life and eternal life than lose our jobs and homes? Listen, folks, listen carefully. Could it be that we got so comfortable here and we love it so much while we sing, oh, how much I love Jesus? Jesus told Israel, when you see the signs, leave Jerusalem and leave the city and go to the mountains to save your life. How many did it? The history says, the spirit of prophecy says that many died. There was so much blood. Why? Why didn't they leave? Oh, they could not give up their homes. They could not give up. They were in Babylon for 70 years and the call came, go back home. How many left Babylon to go back home? Very few. Why? Because they got homes in Babylon and they got jobs in Babylon and they got friends and they got comfortable and their home was in Babylon and they already were like Babylon and they belonged to Babylon. Are we of Babylon when Jesus says, come out of Babylon, my people? Do you follow me? This is extremely important. So long as God gives me power to speak to our people, I shall continue to call upon parents to leave the cities and get homes in the country. We know these paragraphs, don't we? How many do that actually? Not very comfortable. Christ is at the door. This is why I say to our people, do not consider a privation when you are called to leave the cities and move out. We know these paragraphs, don't we? His people are not too crowded in the big cities. He wants them to take their families out, that they may be better prepared for eternal life. In a little while, they will have to leave the cities. Believers are now living in the cities, will have to move to the country, that they may save their children. Wow. Wow. More and more as time advances, our people will have to leave the cities. For years we have been instructed that our brothers and sisters, especially families with children, should plan to leave the cities. As God's commandments keeping people, we must leave the cities. We should work in the cities, but not dwell in them. Now listen, I know it's very uncomfortable. And hey, you are Christians, you should still love me. But these are not my words. These are not my words. So take it or leave it. Why don't we do it? Are we doing like Lot? Are we doing like Jerusalem? Staying there? Are we doing like Israel in Babylon, are we the same when we say we are waiting for Jesus to come? How do we prove that we are actually literally waiting, preparing for Jesus to come? What do we do for it? Daily doing the same thing, investing for now and for here. I am not saying that we should not work. I am not saying that we should not eat. In fact, when you have green beans, call me. I'm coming. I am saying that we should focus on heaven and not be stressed about here and now. Do you hear me? Jesus doesn't say, do not save. He says, do not keep on being stressed over this. But focus first on the kingdom of God. The other things, God will take care of it. God will take care of it. You know the song? God will take care of it. Do you trust that? We should. Listen, many times we lose sight of the promised land, focusing too much on here and now, and forget there and then. Forget that we are transitory here, that everything we do and have is not secure, that Jesus is coming soon, and we should focus on heaven, that we should seek first. And if we get stressed here and lose sight of there, Satan can get us. Wow. Jesus says, do not focus on here and now, but lay up your treasures in heaven, where nobody can take them. Because where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So let me ask you, how do you lay up treasures in heaven? Are you going to save money in heaven, literally write a check and put the address heaven, and they say, Gabriel, please, to angel Gabriel addressed, would you put this money in a safe box for me? Is this what Jesus means, that we send literally physical money to heaven? Or gold? Or is that what God means? Let me ask you, what do you take to heaven? Or how much do you take to heaven from your stuff? I wish I could take how I sold it. But if I had a motorcycle, I really wish I could take my motorcycle to heaven. That would be cool. I am afraid God is not going to let us do that. Yeah, Charles, sorry. It is what it is. I cannot change it. Let me ask you, what do you take to heaven? That's what Jesus says. Lay up treasures in heaven. How do you do that? What do you literally take to heaven? Do you have an answer for me? What? What? And who is that? It's you. If you follow Jesus and have his character, you go to heaven. That's the treasure that Jesus values so much, that God gave his son, that those who love him should go to heaven. And if Jesus paid for you, you must have a lot of value, more than gold or money. Would you agree with me? Would you agree with me? Let me explain a little. Let me explain. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. For who? For you and me. We are the apple of his eye. They shall be like jewels. Do you see that the Bible talks about we being treasures? You are precious in my sight, says the Lord. We have this treasure in earthly vessels, says Paul. Who is God's treasure, folks? It's people. It's not money. It's not homes. God is going to burn those things. You follow me? The most precious treasure in God's eyes is his children. Would you agree with me? It's very clear, because all that goes to heaven is people, period. Nothing else. There is nothing that you'll be able to take to heaven except you and your family, hopefully, and your friends, hopefully. That's who goes to heaven. So how can you actually save your treasure in heaven? Let me explain this. There is no greater treasure than a life, a child of God, saved for eternity. You are called not to be saved alone, but to save others that Jesus died for. Anything that you do, that to draw a person closer to Jesus is actually laying up treasures in heaven. I want you to read it with me, the last one. Would you please do me this favor and loud read it with me? Anything you do that can draw a person closer to Jesus is laying up treasures in heaven. That's what Jesus came for. He didn't come for stuff, to save stuff. He came to save people. And that's what he called you and me for. Not for stuff, but to save people, didn't he? That's our mission. That's the Great Commission. Go from Jerusalem to Judea to the end of the world and do what? Save. Didn't he say that? God wants you to be there, and not just you, but those around you. Your family, your children, your spouse, your relatives, your neighbors, your friends, your co-workers, anybody that you are in touch with. Because God, you are not here by chance. God put you where you are for a reason. Who knows if not you, you are not here for a time like this. You follow me? God put you there because God has people there that you should reach, nobody else, because you know them. And God wants you to reach them because those are the treasures that you actually take to heaven. There is somebody in Washington State, when I gave the prayer seminar to men's retreat there, he asked me, Pastor, you pray for others. What do you want me to pray for you? And I said, Wayne, honestly, literally, my goal, the goal of my life, and I mean that with all my heart, is to take to heaven as many as I can, like crazy. As many as I can using any type of methods. And I said, that's what you should pray for me. I want, when I go to heaven, I want them to come and say, Jesus saved us because you are willing to invest in us. Time, whatever, energy, prayer. I want them to be like, by thousands. I want to jump up and down and scream and get tears and rejoice and sing and go nuts when I see how many. And say, Lord, I am not worthy, but thank you. If it's 10,000, I'm going to live another infinity besides the infinity that Jesus gives me just because 10,000 are there. Isn't that something? Folks, God called you to actually do that. We cannot take stuff there, but we can take people. And Jesus says, do not focus on this here and now, but lay up treasures in heaven. For where your treasure is, that's where your heart will also be. Do not be obsessed with this. Be obsessed with that. Take your children. Take your grandchildren. Don't get connected to Sodom. Get out of Babylon. If you don't do that, when the time of the end comes, the crisis comes, when you hear that you should actually lift up your eyes towards heaven, you may want to actually take somebody to heaven, but it may be too late. And whatever you spent in and invested in may prove to be quicksand. You know what I'm talking about? And you may cry, but it's too late. Because if we believe what we say, then we should invest now in heaven, not just talk about heaven. Talk, it's easy. As I said, you may say you love God, but numbers and priorities talk for themselves. And they say where your heart really is. So, let's move on. Folks, you are not called to be saved alone. God called you to save. In fact, Jesus was willing to give up eternity, to risk everything, to save others. And he wants his children to follow him and do just the same. Be willing to risk everything to save a soul. When you'll get there, you are not going to say, oh man, I had so much in my IRA. I had so much in my 401k. Oh man, I had so much in stocks and savings. You'll say, oh man, I'm so happy I'm here. You follow me? That's what. You are not going to say, oh, I bought a house for all my kids. You are going to say, oh, I'm happy my kids are here. You follow me? You're not going to say to your neighbor, man, how much money did you bring with you here? You'll say, I'm so glad that you are here. What would be heaven without you? I would just suffer and cry. I'm so happy that we can spend eternity together. That's what you'll say. And he's going to come to you and say, hey neighbor, you remember when you came and gave me a Bible study? Well, I didn't really listen, but in my heart I was thinking about it. I was not willing to give up to change my life. And you gave me a DVD and then you had a prayer for me. You remember? And it bothered me and I could not sleep. But you know what? I'm here because of you. Think about this. When your neighbor comes and says, I am here because you invested in me. That's the treasure. That's what Jesus called you for. Anything that you do that would draw a person closer to Jesus and save a person is laying up treasures in heaven. Invest in saving people. Invest in your children. Invest in Christian education. Invest in good books. Invest in prayer. Invest in visiting people. Invest in talking to people. Invest in showing Jesus. Then you can say, here is me and my family and those that I am responsible for, my neighbors, my friends. Folks, everything else is going to burn up. The day of the Lord will come as a thief. And heavens will pass with great noise, and the elements will melt. Both earth and the worlds that are in it, and the homes and the cars, and unfortunately the motorcycles, and everything. Therefore, because all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons we ought to be? Looking for and hastening the coming of the day. Because we focus on new heaven and new earth, not on this stuff. If you believe that Jesus is coming, then your life should prove it. If you love God, then you should love people as passionately as God loves people. Therefore, you are called to save people for heaven. That's the treasure. Jesus is coming soon. I remember I was in Washington men's retreat, as I mentioned. And the guy comes to me, and he was not looking good. And he was big, and he was a lot of muscles. And I'm not very muscular. I have a lot of energy, but I am kind of slim. I cannot help. I could eat forever. I could eat 10 meals a day. I can eat anything. I just don't get a pound. I know it's not fair, but I don't care. Anyway. So, I told him I'm hungry, and I get dizzy if I don't eat all the time. So they brought more food. And this guy comes and says, would you give up your meal and talk to me? I said, but I got to speak again in 1 hour. I spoke that day at 8:30, 9:30, 11, 2, 3, 6, and 8. No more voice. And I said, I'm dizzy, I am hungry, and to be honest, I hate to say what I say. Shame on me, Pastor. I was tired. All the people, after I'm done preaching, instead of letting me take a break because it drains you of energy, it's not as easy as people may think. Instead of letting me just sit down for a second, everybody wanted to talk to me, and they all came, and everybody wants to say something. And I got tired of talking to people. I just wanted to disappear for a second. Sorry. It's not always that. Most of the time, I really enjoy people. But that time, I didn't. Shame on me. And he comes and he says, would you give up your meal? That I was like seeing bread, dreaming bread and green beans. I was hungry. Would you give up your meal and talk to me? And I was like, okay. I hated it. And the Rambo that talks to me says, Pastor, I hate God and I hate pastors and I hate church people. I said, yeah, that's what you want to tell me? That's why I sacrificed my meal? But I didn't say it. I was polite and sweet, loving Jesus and loving people outside. And as I'm smiling, you know, he says, and I want to tell you, my neighbor came to me and talked to me. I said, give me a break. I'm not going to go to a prayer retreat. And he said, well, I could pray for you. I don't need prayer because I don't believe in prayer. And the neighbor came again and again and again. And I would say, no, no. Eventually, I got really upset with the neighbor. Leave me alone. Stop pestering me. And the neighbor said, hey, I know you like nature and fishing. Oh, fishing. Well, there at the prayer retreat, we have a lake. And you don't have to attend prayer. You can come and go fishing. It's for free. Can I? Don't you get upset if I don't attend your meetings? No, I'm happy you come. Okay, deal. And the guy came to go fishing. And he comes, and he's a drug addict. He takes drugs again and again and again and again with some buddies. And he already started to sell drugs, and he was in over his head. You know, and he was in drugs over his head. And he hears everybody singing. And he says, well, they all walk there, and I walk there. He felt bad. He says, I'm going to go inside, just because I am ashamed. Sit down for 10 minutes, and when they pray and nobody can see me, I go out, I go fishing. And as he got inside, he was listening to the prayer seminar. And he was listening and listening and listening, 1 hour, 2 hours. That evening, he came to me. He says, can I talk to you? And then he tells me the story. And he says, today, God has changed my life. And he said, pray for me that I never touch drugs again. Number two, pray for me that I will be in heaven and my family and my children, my wife. Pray for me that I don't go to heaven alone, but I'm going to take all my drug friends, get them saved too. Would you pray for me? I said, oh, I will be glad. You just gave me the story of my day. Listen, it was worth giving up my green beans. And then I thought he just said it. Well, 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 I got home. A month later, he calls me and then he emails me and he asked me to send DVDs. I had Beth and Jim Lyon send him a few sets of DVDs. He got them. He emailed me again. He says, I have a group of 7 drug addicts. We all watched the prayer seminar and now we all want to give up drugs. And I want to let you know, since I listened to the prayer seminar, I never touched drugs again. I don't have a desire. I prayed that God would take it and he did. What a story. I go to heaven and I see my Rambo friend and I see another 7 with him. And he says, hey, you got me and I got them and they got those. And amen. What a story. You go to Cuba. You do Bible studies. You do community outreach. I got an email last night. I'm not going to give names because I didn't ask permission. From New Zealand. And she says, I am watching the sermons online. I am tremendously blessed. Please tell them that I thank them for the effort to put them online. I love to watch the seminars and the sermons so much that because during the day I am busy, I stay late night to watch all of them. I made the decision to teach these principles into my whole church. It seems she is a pastor. I made the decision to teach these principles into my whole church, that we all become a praying, working church. Pray for me and please send me some materials. And then name and so on. Isn't that something? Let me give you a few examples. Jim, and we are actually, after that, we'll finish. So don't worry, just hold on a second. Jim, I want to invite Jim Lyons to come for a second. Where is, here you are. Jim, I want you to talk a little to the church about how we as a church impact the world. Yes, you heard the world.
I know we spend a lot of money, a lot of effort in this work. I was looking at the hits. Our average daily hits on the church website is from 3,000 to 3,500.
That's daily?
That's daily.
Okay, keep going.
A month. 80,000 to 100,000.
100,000 a month? Nobody said amen. Come on.
Downloaded files, 2,500 to 3,000 daily.
Daily.
75,000 to 80,000 a month.
And that's only on the church website, but keep going, please.
Another interesting point is we've got more hits on About Us in the last couple of months, 240. About SDAs, 35. What SDAs Believe, 37. Contact Us, 254.
Hold on. I'm sorry. I got to interrupt you. You mean that there are people who are not SDAs who try to get in touch and say, we are listening, we are watching, we need to know more. What is SDA? Who are you guys? Basically, what do you believe in? That's what you say?
That's right.
Praise the Lord. Keep going. I cannot. I'm excited.
Bible studies, 175, and even on John Bradshaw's sermons that we have online, 220.
Amen.
The top URLs, that's where our information is embedded. Of course, our church website, about 1,400. Unknown, about 980, about 1,000.
And listen,
almost 200 on Yahoo, Allura, 200, and Bing, about 100. And those are just...
Praise the Lord. And listen, not only people checking on us, but also on Vimeo, that is not our church website, people who listen to the sermons, 26,000, added to the other numbers, that's above and beyond. Folks, who are we? We are nothing. We cannot change ourselves, moreover, to change somebody else. And God called you and me to save people? Isn't that a privilege? And this is not me. This is you. And this is God doing the job. Because Jim, who works hard, and Mona, and Andre, and people at the cameras, and everybody, and you, and the board, because this is money, this is time, this is investing. Yet they cannot change a heart. It is the Holy Spirit.
And in addition to that, we've got Vimeo that people watch the videos on. And over the last year, we've had about 26,000 plays.
Above everything else.
Plays and downloads. And the number one performer, the one that's watched more than anything else, is Vital Prayers to Know God.
People watch prayer. What a privilege. Thank you so much, Jim. I appreciate it. Sorry to call on you, but I wanted the church to know about this. Jesus didn't come to focus on self or on stuff. And he called us to follow him. Pick a Bible study. Go and give up. Don't be concerned if you succeed. Listen, a religion is very tough. I hope you still love me, because this is not my words. Listen carefully. A religion that leads men to place a low estimate upon human beings, whom Christ has esteemed so much that he gave himself. A religion that would lead us to be careless of human needs, sufferings, rights, is a spurious, false religion. Wow! In slighting the claims of the poor, in suffering and the sinful, we are proving ourselves traitors to Christ. It is because men take upon themselves the name of Christ, while in life they deny his character, that Christianity has so little power. The name of the Lord is blasphemed because of these things. Isn't that strong? I hope you read it. I'm going to leave it for a few more seconds. I will make it available to you if you want. Solemns are lessons of Israel's failure. They turned away from their purpose. And listen, today we must not do the same. We got to finish the work that was committed to us. The conflict calls for a spirit of self-denial, dependence on God, and using every opportunity to save the lost. The Lord's blessing will attend his church as they advance united, as they try to save others in self-sacrifice, loving service for others. There are souls to be saved, and may you be co-workers with Jesus Christ in saving these souls for whom Christ has given his life. The Lord will bless you in the good fruit you may bear for his glory. The reason is so much dwarfed religion today is because people have not brought practical self-denial into their lives. So, that's it. We are done. Focus on Jesus. Invest in Jesus. Invest in heaven. Save souls, because that's what is not going to disappear. The others will burn. That means to follow Jesus. You heard me? Folks, Jesus is calling this church and is calling you to lay up treasures in heaven. Let's pray. Father, we just cannot believe that while we are in the way, you still want us to work for you. Therefore, in humbleness, we make ourselves available. Each one of us, we call today that you will help us not to go home and forget, but to actually start investing in heaven. Not be stressed about this stuff, but focus on that place. Because yes, Jesus is coming sooner than we think. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.